Welcome to the Blender Basics Classroom Tutorials. These video tutorials are designed to accompany the Blender Basics Classroom Tutorial book that is available for free download from the Central Dauphin School District website. That website is www.cdschools.org/cdhs. And all you would need to do is go to that website, look under staff, and find my name, Jim Chronister, and it will take you to a link to be able to download the book. And again, these tutorials are designed to accompany the booklet and the chapters that are in it, and not really designed to replace them. For the best experience and getting a quick start in Blender, I would recommend reading the chapters and using the video tutorials. This tutorial tonight will go along with Chapter 1, the Blender Interface. To get started, I'm going to go in here and start a brand new Blender file. If you've gone to the Blender website, which is www.blender.org, you find the current version of Blender and download it. Tonight I'm working with the test candidate for Blender Release 2.57. When you first download and install Blender and launch it for the first time, you'll see a scene very similar to what I have right now. You see multiple viewports or windows open on your screen. Right now you have a 3D viewport right here in the middle, and then you'll have a couple of viewports over here to the right hand side. You'll see an outliner viewport. You'll see a properties window over here. This used to be called the button windows. You can change every window type by clicking on these small buttons in the corner. Like right here is a 3D window. I could choose a different type of viewport over here, and a lot of these viewports will be discussed in later chapters. You'll notice that a lot of your buttons are off the screen. This Blender 2.5 2.6 is a complete rework of all previous versions of Blender. The developers have been working very hard for several years to come up with this new and improved version of Blender. And at first, if you are familiar with the older versions of Blender, it will seem very different and very difficult to work with. But then as I've worked with it, I've realized how much nicer this is, and commands and features have been regrouped and reorganized, and it's just done. They've done a really wonderful job with it. You have your properties window over here on the side, and you'll notice that you have several buttons going across the top. If I were to hold down my middle mouse wheel like it is a button, I can actually scroll back and forth on these buttons to see all the different various panels that are available. And I can also go on the buttons that relate to them down here below them, and I can scroll up and down with the mouse wheel also. And this is probably the most confusing thing with the new version of Blender, is that you have so many options and you're scrolling a lot to be able to see all of everything that's available. Down at the bottom of your screen, you'll see a timeline window. You can also scroll in there by holding down the mouse wheel and scroll through the buttons. You'll see some standard play, fast forward, rewind type buttons available down here to work in time. Because remember, in a computer animation, you are working through time through frames. Here we show you the start and end frames of our animation, the default 250 frames for a movie. Over here to the left-hand side, you'll see something very new to Blender. It's called the Tool Shelf. In the Tool Shelf, you'll see a lot of common commands that we've used in Blender in the past, where we've had to access them most of the time, usually through key commands. Blender is very key command oriented, and it will make your experience with Blender go a lot faster the quicker you get to know some of these different key commands, and everything can be resized. If this panel gets in your way and gets annoying, you can always just minimize it. You want to open it back up, you can hit the small plus, it will open that panel back up. And you also have a little plus over here on the right hand side. This has taken the place of the old numeric window in Blender. If you hit the N key on your keyboard, you can open and close that window as well, and use the small plus, and this will give you data related to the object that's selected on your screen. So if you notice, I can have its location, its rotation, its scale. Here's a neat feature called grease pencil, where you can do some markup on your screen. A lot of people have done some variation work on that. Your view, you have display, you can work with background images. A lot of these will be discussed in later chapters, but not right now. Just close that window back up again. You can maneuver around in 3D space by scrolling your mouse wheel. You can hold down your mouse wheel and rotate around. If you hold down the shift key and the mouse wheel, you can actually pan. And again, the next chapter will actually deal with maneuvering around in 3D space a little bit more. Some of the other nice things about Blender, you have various screens that you can work with. Whenever we talk about changing your screens, by default, it says default. I can change this to something different, like animation, and they give you a different screen configuration to work with animation. Or let's say you want to work with a computer game engine in Blender. Here would be some of the computer game logic where you can actually set things up. And the video editing, if you've worked with programs like Windows Movie Maker or Adobe Premiere, you can actually do video editing and put things together and add sounds. You can do all of that right within Blender too. You've got a preview window and you can drop in your objects in this timeline and create your movies that way as well. So Blender is, you know, an all for all. Everything's in there. It's like the spaghetti sauce. It's all there. Some of the other nice things about Blender. Let's talk about the file saving process. When you go to save a brand new file, it'll take you over to this window. You have a small arrow that will take you back a directory. This would be your path. This would be your file name. Right now I'm defaulted to C:\users chronister documents. Okay, if I keep hitting this back, it'll keep going back one folder at a time. All of your various drives will be listed here. Folders that you've already referenced will be showing up down here. You can also do navigation up here across the top of the window. You can change the way that you're looking at things in here. Here would be thumbnails for all of this. So you can go into various, you know, different things in here and go back. You can do filtering of different types of files that you want to look at. If you just want to look at Blender files, right there you go. You know, I could go in here and go into my documents and, you know, just find various folders in here and files. So if I went into here, Blender, the Blender Basics, here are various Blender files themselves. Maybe I want to look at some image files. Okay, and here I'm filtering through image files now that I can work with, and movies that have been made. So you can change a lot of things here. You type in the name of the file down here, hit Save Blender, and you're all good to go. I'm not going to save it right now. Other things that you can work with in Blender, importing and exporting from other programs. Now, right now, Blender by default does not have very many imports and exports loaded in there. You would have to load those in. One nice thing about Blender that you may want to do, external data. You usually want to maybe pack that into your Blend file, especially if you plan on working on this file on different machines, like saving it to a flash drive and taking it to work or school with you and opening it on another machine. If you've loaded pictures, for example, let's say I put a texture on this cube that is a picture of a brick wall. Well, if I don't pack the data in with this Blend file, I'll take it to another machine and it won't know where to find that texture. It won't be available with my file. If I've added sounds for the game engine, they won't automatically go with the Blender file. I would need to go in here to external data and pack it into the Blend file. Now that that's done, all of those features become part of the Blender file and it's transportable. Now, let's say you want to change some other things in Blender. Here's an option for user preferences. If I click that, it'll open a brand new window for me, and I have some options in here of how I can change the way Blender opens and operates for me. My recommendation is do not hit the Save as Default button on a public computer, such as in a school building, because that will become the new standard of what you're working with. But here are some of the things you can change in the user interfaces. You can change some different things in here about how the grid is operated with and where the object origin, the size of it, while editing. You can do some different things in here too. When you add new objects, well, how are they going to be aligned? I prefer to add things and align them to the view that I'm working with. Okay, and if I want that to come up that way every time I launch Blender, I would hit the Save as Default and it would save it like that and come up every time. Underneath Input, let's say you're working with a laptop computer that doesn't have a number pad. Blender is very reliant on the number pad for view commands. You can hit this Emulate Number Pad button, and you can change just about everything with Blender the way that it works. I'm going to skip the Add-ons tab, go to Themes. Let's say you want to change your whole color configuration of every window. You can do it and save it as a theme to work with. And a lot of people have creative themes that you can download off the internet. File. Let's say you have a folder full of textures. And by the way, if you would like to just get started with Blender and have a whole library full of textures, Blender really doesn't come with too much to begin with. If you go to the CD School's website, you will find the texture library that we work with. I've compiled it and put it together and put it out on the web so you can work with that. So you could click on this little file folder and you could tell it where to look for those textures every time. So when you go to apply a new texture, you don't have to browse through your computer to find it. It'll go right to this folder. Same thing with sounds and a lot of your other settings. And again, you could hit save as default and it'll keep it for every time. Under system, you can change some of the way that the ways that Blender works with your computer. Let's say you know, you want to do a lot of work with your sequence editor and this just isn't enough memory cache and it's a little jerky. You can take the memory cache up and the way that it looks, it sounds. You know, there are a lot of things that you can change here. Add-ons, this is a great place to go. You can filter what type of add-ons you're looking at, but dynamic spacebar may be one that you want to press. It'll give you more options when you hit the spacebar and bring up some different menu options. The spacebar is what people are used to using in the old Blender for adding new objects. You can add like different types of meshes, bolt factory, gears, pipe joints. We do a lot of mechanical development, so those are some nice features to have available automatically. And these are all scripts that people have written and added into Blender. Another nice thing here are importers and exporters down in the list. So if you work with a specific program, like an Autodesk project or program, or you work with 3D Studio or something, you can turn on and enable these importers and exporters so that they're available all the time. So there are a lot of things that you can do in here with your user preferences. I'm just going to exit out of them right now. And that's really about it for our introduction. So join us with the second chapter as we start maneuvering around in 3D space.